Hello, everyone. I'm meteorologist Davis Nolan. One of the strange things about the flooding in New Orleans from Hurricane Katrina was the fact that the fiercest winds and the heaviest rains had passed, and many residents were going outside trying to assess the damage. Now, though during the storm, many of the eastern suburbs of New Orleans, like the Ninth Ward, and some of the eastern areas like Chalmette and St. Bernard Parish, had experienced devastating flooding, the greater New Orleans area had been left unscathed by floodwaters, at least so far. So you can imagine my surprise when, while doing TV cut-ins on Katrina here in Nashville, that I received word that my 80-year-old parents' house was taking on water and they were being rescued by boat. Now, luckily, after a long ordeal, they were able to be evacuated to Baton Rouge. Now, this picture pretty much tells the story. You're looking northward towards Lake Pontchartrain. The famous 17th Street Canal that caused all of this flooding is just off the left part of your screen. And even my parents' home is about three blocks down this street that you see right here. This is Interstate 10 curving westward off towards Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Now, off in the distance, you see Southern Yacht Club on fire, burning from a gas fire that happened during the storm. This is where I grew up sailing sailboats as a child. To explain what happened sort of takes a little bit of a geography lesson. You see, the normal thinking of the right-hand part of the storm causing the storm surge with the onshore flow is sort of flip-flop for New Orleans. With Lake Pontchartrain to the north, it's the left side of the storm, or the west side with a strong northerly flow, which could push the waters of Lake Pontchartrain southward towards New Orleans and testing the levees along the lakefront and also the levees and flood walls of the adjoining canals. But we have to step back just a little further still. When a storm approaches from the south, you have a strong easterly flow, sometimes for days. Now notice the V-shaped wedge created by the Mississippi River here and the Mississippi Gulf Coast right here. Well, this V-shaped wedge allows the water to build up in this area well out ahead of the storm. That water makes its way through the tributaries into Lake Pontchartrain, causing it to rise sometimes several feet before the storm even makes landfall. Now, I've always been told, even as a child, that the worst case scenario was a landfall right near the Louisiana-Mississippi border. Indeed, that's what happened with Katrina. Now, back in 1969, Hurricane Camille, a Category 5, took just about this same course. But Camille was so small that it didn't cause the problems that Katrina did. But Katrina had hurricane force winds out to 125 miles and tropical storm force winds out to 230 miles, and hence the devastation. This map here shows the areas at or below sea level in New Orleans in shades of pink and purple, as you can see in the key. I also have all the major canals circled in yellow with the breaches noted. Now, the Industrial Canal here caused the severe flooding in eastern sections of New Orleans. But greater New Orleans, the flooding was caused by the breach right here on the 17th Street Canal. And check out the result. Notice on the right part of the screen, everything is in blue. That's the floodwaters. And on the left side of the canal, everything is in gray, where it was dry in Metairie or Jefferson Parish. The breach was right here, only on one side of the canal, and that's why it's only flooded on one side. And that water made its way all the way to downtown. Here's the Superdome right here. Now notice some of the floodwaters tried to migrate westward into Jefferson Parish or Metairie, as you see here. But what we call the Metairie Ridge right here, a former natural levee made by the Mississippi River thousands of years ago, it stopped the water from migrating northward. Otherwise, we'd have had the same flooding on both sides of the canal. Now, as we said, the flooding made its way all the way downtown. Here's the Superdome with the roof half torn off right here. But notice where I have the red line, the water stopped. Well, the natural levee from the Mississippi River, created by thousands of years of the river flooding during spring floods and depositing sediments, well, that stopped the water right at downtown, maybe a block or so past the Superdome. And for years, man only lived in downtown New Orleans, either the French Quarter or downtown or somewhere along the Mississippi River where the higher ground was created by the natural levee. But as time went on, man ventured further and further out away from the highlands of the natural levee of the Mississippi River. As levees were built and pumping stations were built, a lot of the swamp land that at one time was nothing but fishing holes and crawfish ponds finally became neighborhoods where people lived all the way out to the lakefront. You might say we were sort of setting ourselves up for a fall. And as a matter of fact, my house is located right on the 17th Street Canal. My parents' house, where I also grew up, is located right here, and you can see the blue water in the streets. We had about 7.5 feet of water in the peak, and then it came down and stayed at about 6 feet for several days before slowly going down over 2.5 weeks or so. So what happened? Well, you're not going to believe some of the parts of the story that I'm about to tell you. This is a diagram of the 17th Street Canal flood wall. Now, the water never actually went over the top of the flood wall. It went underneath it, undermining it and causing it to fail. See, down below the surface of the earth, we had a layer of porous, unstable peat. That's the old swamp that had been covered up by years of dirt and mud. And it extended from around 11 feet below sea level down to 30 feet below sea level. And before they built this flood wall, they did borings, or what we call core samples, where they go down below the surface of the earth and actually find out how deep the layers are. Well, when they did their borings, they found, sure enough, from 11 feet down to 30 feet down below sea level, there was a layer of old swamp or peat that they had to bang these flood walls through in order to keep the water from undermining it and going to the other side. When they transferred the data of the borings and core samples to a cross section, much like you see here, they made a clerical error. They said that the old layer of peat stopped at about 15 feet down. So when the engineers designed the wall to go down to 17.5 feet, they thought they were going 2.5 feet below the layer of swamp. And what's worse, they were told in that cross-section that there was a layer of impervious clay from around 15 feet down. And that impervious clay wouldn't allow water to flow through it. So they thought they were designing a wall that would keep the water from undermining it and hence causing it to fail. This is an aerial picture of the breach in the 17th Street Canal. It's facing westward, so north is this way, and you can see all the debris piled up against this bridge coming in from Lake Pontchartrain. And you can definitely see the water flowing from the canal into Lakeview, and as I said, this water went all the way downtown to the Superdome. But what you can't see in this picture, because of all the sun glint here, is that the wall actually slid backwards. It didn't fall down in some spots, it just slid backwards, in some cases up to 35 feet backwards. Now, I have another picture of the London Avenue Canal breach. This one didn't cause as much flooding, but had a very similar situation. The sheet piling had a gray concrete cap on top of them. There's no sun glint in this picture, so you can actually still see the top of the wall still standing up in some cases along this breach here, although it did fall down right in the middle where the gray cap disappears underneath the water. Now, as we mentioned before, the severe flooding for the eastern parts of New Orleans, like the Ninth Ward and eastern suburbs like Chalmette, including St. Bernard Parish, were caused by the Industrial Canal. That's the navigational canal that connects Lake Pontchartrain to the Mississippi River. Now, the water actually did go over the tops of the flood walls along the entire 10-mile length of this canal from the lake to the river, and there were four breaches identified, two to the west and two to the east. Now, the two to the east caused the most severe damage and flooding in the lower Ninth Ward. Here's the Industrial Canal extending southward towards the Mississippi River, and here's where the breach occurred. And check this picture out. Now, here the water is actually flowing back out into the canal, but look what the force of the water did. These houses were knocked off of their foundations and floated into the neighborhood of the lower Ninth Ward as the water pummeled in from the canal. Now, the flooding may have been worsened by the intercoastal canal you see here and also what we call the Mississippi River Gulf Outlet Canal, which connects down to the Gulf of Mexico. Notice how they both come together and then intersect the Industrial Canal at just about a 90-degree angle. Now, as a wide mouth of view, you can see both of these canals eventually go out to the Gulf of Mexico. And you remember what I told you about the water coming up for days ahead of a storm from that strong easterly flow? Well, that same water was able to go through these canals, intersecting with the Industrial Canal, and that, we think, exacerbated the flooding along that area. So how did what they now say was Category 3 Katrina do so much more damage in flooding than Category 5 Hurricane Camille did back in 1969? Well, I think there's two reasons, the first one being the size of the storm. As we said, Katrina was huge and Hurricane Camille was very, very small. But I think the second reason lies in the fact that it was a Category 5 storm the day before it came ashore. This is the 10 a.m. advisory from the Hurricane Center on Sunday morning when the storm came ashore early Monday morning. And the winds were up to 175 miles per hour for about 12 hours before it actually made landfall. And I believe that Category 5 strength that close to shore, again with that V-shaped wedge from the mouth of the river up to the Mississippi Gulf Coast, helping pile water into it, made the flooding so much worse for both New Orleans as well as the Mississippi Gulf Coast. I'm News 2 meteorologist Davis Nolan.